Dear students, good morning. Welcome to Law Excellence IAS. Let us start the discussion on today's newspaper, that is 23rd September 2020. The first article for discussion is A New World Order. This is written in the context of 75th anniversary of United Nations Organization. You know that UN as an organization came into existence after Second World War. The victors of the Second World War, they became the permanent members of UN Security Council. Only exception is China, which got added later. Now, Prime Minister Modi has stated that it needs a reform. If not, it faces an existential crisis. What he exactly said is, it is an outdated structure and it is facing a crisis of confidence. Why we need UN reform? Let us analyze. UN Security Council, UN General Assembly. Among these two, which is more representative? UN General Assembly. If we see the power imbalance between them, UN Security Council enjoys abnormally high power due to its veto power. So we need to bring in a rebalance between UN General Assembly and UN Security Council. Second is, it is non-representative. If you see, the five members of UN Security Council are from various regions where few other regions are missing. Let me put it this way. Europe, a small continent, has two members and other continents, they are missing as a whole. Let us take South America, Africa, Australia. They do not have any representation. Added to that, after globalization, multilateral economic groupings are gaining significance. Let us talk about G4, Germany, Japan, India, Brazil. These countries are active in promoting the multilateral economic affairs. They do not have any strong presence in UN. After that, UN Security Council, the five members, these are conflicting and they are major powers. As they are divided, they are blocking each other's agendas. They are driven more by their personal agendas rather than collective wish for peace and security in the world. That's how I can put it as. So, intergovernmental negotiations is been established for UN reform. What was the agenda before that? Enlarging the Security Council, creating new categories of membership. Let us see here carefully. Palestine, Taiwan, how these have to be identified with the UN General Assembly. This is always an issue. Next is questioning of the veto powers. Finally, redistributing Security Council and General Assembly power balance. With this agenda, intergovernmental negotiations are being started. There is no headway on these negotiations, which has to be initiated immediately. This can be a question this year. The reason is an important event is happening in the history of UN this year. The next article is making the language of the law comprehensible. What is the importance of language in India? Language is a political identity, a cultural glue that connects the people with each other. It is necessary for better governance. Can I say this way? So that's why the government is also emphasizing on teaching in mother tongue in early ages for better learning outcomes of the children. So when language is so important, then why can't the governance and legal framework take this language seriously in India is the question posed by the author over here. Today, running administration and publicizing languages, laws in local languages, is essential for good governance. See carefully, that is the basis for linguistic states in India, one of the bases. But there is a lot of confusion with regard to publicizing and promoting the central laws in local languages. Let us see this. The first is, there is no clarity on the legal position. One, Authority to Text Central Laws Act 1973, it states that there has to be authoritative translation of central laws orders into local languages. Official Languages Act 1963, it states publication of laws in English and Hindi only. Second, an inclusive language policy is missing in India. So the central agencies, they take only Hindi and English as the basis. Only UIDAI has this inclusive language policy in conducting its business. The immediate need of the hour is to bring in an inclusive language policy where every authoritative text in India is publicized in 22 different languages, which are recognized under Schedule 8 of the Constitution. Next is, lack of knowledge of a law is always detrimental to rule of law. How can I defend if I don't have an authority of law on my side, or if I don't have knowledge of law on my side? On the other side, government says that translating the laws into various languages will create legal uncertainties and ambiguities. But how the European Union is doing that? European Union is translating its laws and authoritative texts into 24 different languages. So finally, what the author is saying is, in the interests of administration, in the interests of rule of law, and to ensure better reach of the laws to the people, publicizing the laws and transmitting the information to the citizens in different languages under Schedule 8 is very important. The next is, e-learning in India, a case of bad education. What is the purpose of education? Let us start it there. Education is a systematic transfer of existing knowledge. Do you agree with me? It is a systematic, organized way of transmitting the knowledge to the next generation kids. Obviously, this knowledge becomes the basis for their opportunities and also creates a collective consciousness among the people that we belong to, a particular society, a particular way of life. So education is important for cultural and knowledge transmission. So it sustains the civilizations. Do you agree? And if you see, right to equality under Article 14 of the Constitution talks about equal opportunities for all. So what is the basis for equal opportunity? Equality in education is the basis for equal opportunity. If there is inequality in education, obviously opportunities will be taken up by few, elite sections of the society. So here author says this, today e-learning and digital divide, it is rising the inequality in this country. Inequality in learning, inequality in education, and inequality in outcomes finally will lead to inequality in opportunities. And there is poor quality of education. You know that lack of internet connectivity, obviously the rural students gets worst affected. In these circumstances, poor quality of education will lead to poor learning outcomes. Poor learning outcomes will further kill students' enthusiasm, curiosity to learn. Finally, technology is a means for anything. Technology is not an end. Today, technology in itself is becoming an end rather than learning becoming the end. So post-COVID-19, the schools are planning to use the technological platforms to make the children learn the new things. Remember, teacher, school are irreplaceable with technology. So learning shall happen with reflection, observation, and conscious guidance of the students by the well-trained teachers. That is the essence of education all about. Next is precarious houses. In every monsoon, we see the collapse of buildings. Recently, it happened in Bhiwandi. How to prevent them? That is the central point of this article. One is self-certified pre-monsoon safety audits. Every owner has to give a safety audit with regard to their building structure, and architects also need to certify that particular building. So second is political interference is very high in the functioning of the municipal bodies. If any building, dilapidated building, has to be collapsed, local leadership comes to the rescue of the owner. So free hand to the municipal authorities to classify the buildings and to analyze them is essential. Finally, repairs have to be incentivized. Let us take property tax is being levied onto them. So after certain period of age, the property tax can be reduced and this can be incentivized to give for repairs. In this context, most of the people who are vulnerable and live in dilapidated buildings are weak and marginalized. State has to take the special effort towards development of decent, affordable social accommodation for these weak and marginalized. This is what stated here. Next article is uniting to combat COVID-19. This article's essential argument is, we all fought COVID-19 in silos. No country is in cooperation with the other countries, especially in South Asia. Prime Minister Modi called for SAARC COVID-19 fund, but it did not move forward. So SAARC appears to be dead almost. So it is the time. This crisis can be an opportunity to revive SAARC. There are many structures existing under SAARC which can be used for greater collaboration. Let us talk about SAARC food banks, SAARC finance forum. All these can be used to have a collective effort in the region to fight the COVID-19 menace. The next article is Army talks positive but no headway on de-escalation. You know, External Affairs Minister level talks spoke about de-escalation and disengagement. At the Corps commander level, it is not moving forward. But there is one step positive, that is involvement of civilian officer, a joint secretary level officer from Indian side. And second, both the armies agreed not to build up the troops at the border. And second thing, most important thing is China is upgrading its infrastructure near border in the last 3 years. 13 new military facilities, including airports and heliports, have come there. It is a strategy of China. The same is applied in South China Sea. It is to bring in a localized military superiority. And obviously, this helps the China to escalate the conflict. And second thing, it also increases the cost of opposition to China. So opponents, they become weak by spending in proportion to China. So this is the same strategy, probably it is applying at the land boundary border too. Next is Lok Sabha clears 3 labor bills. What are these 3 labor bills? Industrial Relations Code Bill 2020, Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code 2020, Code on Social Security 2020. So previously multiple laws which are conflicting and confusing existing, these are being consolidated, and organized, unorganized sector workers are going to get better social security. And the second thing is Interstate Migrant Workmen Act 1979 was subsumed under Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code 2020. This Interstate Migrant Workmen Act was very much in the news during COVID-19 migrant crisis in India. These are the articles for today. Thank you very much. Signing off, Dr. Rambabu for Law Excellence.